Hello, I'm Beverly Weaver, and welcome to Denver Decides. This community partnership is dedicated to accessible and transparent elections. The partnership includes the League of Women Voters of Denver, Interneighborhood Cooperation, and is presented by Denver ATV. Our mission today is to present a candidate forum in anticipation of the general election coming up on Tuesday, November 8th. Among other offices, this election includes the candidates vying to represent constituents in Colorado State House from District 8. District 8 encompasses part of central, north, and northeast Denver. Our format is a pretty standard one. The candidates will have timed opening and closing statements. We'll begin with opening statements, and that'll be followed by rounds of questions that have been submitted by organizers of the forum, as well as the public speaking and civic engagement students from Metropolitan State University. Now, since we do have a time limit, we may not be able to get to all of the submitted questions. Both candidates will answer all the questions. All of your responses, candidates, will be timed. And as you can see, our timers are out here in front. Hopefully you'll be able to view the cards they hold up. So let's begin by meeting the candidates vying to represent Colorado House District 8 as your next state representative. And if you would, audience, please hold your applause until both candidates have been introduced. The candidates are standing left to right facing the audience in the order their names will appear on the November ballot. So beginning at my right is Leslie Herod, and on my left is Evan Vanderpool. Let's welcome them to the forum tonight. Thank you for being here as well, audience. All right, we're going to begin with the opening statements. So we'll begin, one more quick note before we do that. The candidates, on behalf of your viewers at home, as well as the forum organizers in the audience here tonight, we would urge you to please be honest, direct, and forthright to help the voters really distinguish between the two candidates for this office. All right, as I said, we're going to begin with a 1.5 minute opening statement from each candidate, and we're going to proceed in ballot order. So, Leslie Herod, you will have the first shot at a 90-second opening statement when you're ready.
Thank you. Well, good evening. My name is Leslie Herod, and I am running to be your next state representative for House District 8. You know, my mom was a single mom, an officer in the military, and a nurse. She taught me from an early age the importance of discipline, hard work, and public service. I followed her example and dedicated my entire life to public service, including serving as Governor Ritter's senior policy advisor and as a mentor at our local high schools. So as you can see, public service has meant a lot to me and my community. Already in this campaign, I have knocked thousands of doors, probably including your own, and asked the community what issues are important to you. What I found was the issues that matter most to you matter to most of us here in Colorado, and those are the things that I will focus on and I will fight for. They include a good quality education for all of our students, regardless of their zip code, affordable housing for our families and for our affordability for our communities, as well as a criminal justice system that is fair and keeps our communities safe. So I will continue to fight for these issues as you've asked me to, and I hope to be your next state representative in House District 8. Thank you.
All right, thank you, Ms. Herod. Let's move over to Evan Vanderpool, and you, sir, also have a 90-second opening statement.
Hello, I'm Evan Vanderpool, and I'm running for the Colorado House of Representatives to move Denver into the future. The future of a political system that isn't dominated by one-sided views and stalemates. Too many of our politicians on both sides of the aisle refuse to work together in a positive way to help Coloradans. We have experienced tremendous growth these past several years and are now faced with both its opportunities and its challenges. I believe we can meet all of the above with simple, conservative solutions, both fiscally and socially. Leadership that fiscally focuses on common sense budgeting and efficient government spending. Socially, I firmly believe that a government elected by the people should not be in the business of differentiating amongst its citizens. We all must be treated equally, whether male or female, black or white, a member of the LGBT community, Catholic like myself or Muslim. We all must enjoy our individual rights and freedoms and respect our neighbors in return. I'm a self-employed businessman and will apply that experience to keep our economy growing and creating jobs. My wife Sarah and I live in Bellevue Hale and are expecting a baby girl at Rose any day now. We ask for your vote and support to keep Denver as a great place to work and raise a family. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Vanderpool. Now we're going to launch right into our questions prepared by our forum organizers. Each candidate will have a minute to respond to that question. We're going to start in reverse order. So when you finish that sip, it's a longer question. You're fine. We're going to begin with you, Evan. And the first question is, considering all the new developments springing up throughout Denver and, of course, the state, what are your plans to preserve green space and maintain a healthy environment in District 8? 1 minute.
Well, I think we are blessed in District 8 with quite a few parks that we have existing, or you know, already. And I think the new development at 9th and Colorado has done a great job of including green space in their plans that they have being constructed currently. But transportation is a big one as well with all the new developments that we have coming in. We already have a difficult time getting around town as is, and traffic is becoming an issue as far as a environmental standpoint with all of the pollution and high traffic areas. So I think that's something that's going to be very important to deal with, as well as protecting the green space, although I feel like we already have a good infrastructure currently for that.
Okay, let's move to you, Leslie. 1 minute, same question.
Sure. Well, you know, District 8 does have amazing green spaces. We've got everything from Cheesman Park to City Park and all of our boulevards. And those are things that we really need to maintain because that's what makes our district so great. So I will make sure, fight to make sure that those things stay and that we add to our green spaces. My opponent, Evan, mentioned transportation. We've got some major corridors in District 8, including Colfax and Colorado Boulevard. I'd love to see more greenery added into the transportation plan around those areas. And so those are things that I definitely will work on, but it's also making sure that our public lands stay public lands and that we keep them upkept and safe for all of our citizens.
All right. Thank you for those responses. We're going to move to our next question. Leslie, you'll be first on this one. What do you think should be done about our current approach to punishment of crime and rehabilitation? 1 minute.
Sure. So I believe that we have an addiction to jailing people in Colorado and our country. We have to do a better job at criminal justice reform, starting with sentencing reform. We have to make sure that when we do put people in jail, it is for an amount of time that makes sense, and then we have to rehabilitate them. We have to make sure that their reentry into public is one that helps them to get back into society, to get jobs, to be able to take care of their families, so that they can become productive members of our society. It's also really important that for folks who do have a substance abuse issue or even a mental health issue, that we give them the treatment that they need and deserve and not just put them in jail. So I will fight to make sure that we have more mental health care options here in Colorado and access to the treatment and the prescriptions that folks need.
All right. And Mr. Vanderpool, your response. Same question.
Yeah, I think Leslie touched on a very important point of that one is mental health in the state of Colorado. And it's something that is going to reach out and touch a lot of different policy areas, but crime and punishment is certainly one of them. We need to work on rehabilitating people and bringing them back to being productive members of society. I mean, obviously there needs to be a fair balance between punishing crime and being tough on crime, but for people that who will have a better time in our society and being good productive members of society, not only do you get the human benefit of, you know, having them be productive citizens, but also that's helping our budget because, hey, we're not paying to put people into prison. But I think the mental health issue is a large part of that. But again, I don't want to get soft on crime because as I was leaving to head over here, there was a bank robbery on Colfax and Albion right in our district. And that's something that we have to balance, but we have to be tough on crime.
All right. And Evan, you're going to be first to answer this question. In your opinion, what are the pros and cons of Amendment 70, which raises the minimum wage in Colorado from $8.31 an hour to $12 an hour by the year 2020?
Well, look, the goal of raising the minimum wage is to try and, you know, get people better off in life and to put more money in their pockets, but that is not the correct way to do it. Right now, we need to be worried about protecting our economy and having our economy succeed. And the best way to have people, you know, climb the ladder and do better in their professional lives is not by chopping off the bottom rung of the ladder. You know, raising the minimum wage is, there's always this idea that there's just all this money floating around in the ether, and if we raise the minimum wage, that's just going to take money from somewhere and give it to people that need it, but that's not how it works. The business that wants to grow and add a new employee, they can't do it anymore. The company that wants to maybe add more hours to their existing staff, they can't do it anymore because they can't afford it. I think we need to be very careful about our economy at this point in time, and the goal that raising the minimum wage has, it doesn't achieve it.
Okay, and let's move to you, Leslie, your answer to that question, the opinion, pros and cons of Amendment 70.
Thank you. I fully support Amendment 70. I do believe that we need to raise the minimum wage in Colorado, and I applaud all of the folks who've worked so hard to compromise, to make a compromise solution that works for a lot of Coloradans, including a lot of our businesses. So it's a staggered approach. We are looking at increasing the minimum wage by 2020 to $12. And so I think that that's really important and something that we need to do. It's important that our families and that our workers have access to a good living wage. And that's what this is really getting at. That helps all of us. It helps our economy. It helps them to be able to spend more in our economy, but it also helps them to take care of their families. And that's really what our goal should be.
All right. Candidates, you both had a chance to listen and answer to some questions here, three rounds of questions. Now you're each going to be given 30 seconds for a follow-up. If you could make that something, maybe expanding on one of your previous answers or mentioning something that your opponent has said. Leslie, we'll begin with you.
Yeah, I'd love to follow up with you a little bit more when you introduced yourself, you talked about the LGBT community. I wanted you to talk a little bit more about what you feel like needs to happen in the LGBT community to continue to move progress forward.
And this is not really an opportunity to ask questions. We'll have that later.
Okay.
Your chance to follow up on something he said or perhaps expand a little bit on what you had to say.
Okay, well,
apologies,
I will.
Apologies, that wasn't clear.
That's okay. And I think I'll go back to the jailing issue. I will say that our communities in Northeast Denver specifically, and communities of color and low-income communities, are over-policed right now. And so it's really important that we do look at that criminal justice issue. If we want to keep people out of jail, we have to give them a real chance to succeed. That starts with ending the school-to-prison pipeline, right, so that we aren't putting kids in jail who are just trying to go to school. And that goes through all the way to rehabilitation and getting folks back into our community. So the criminal justice question and issue is not one that's short-lived. It's one that really we have to think of a continuum of options.
Okay. Thank you very much, Leslie. And Evan, we're going to come to you again. It's just that follow-up, your own thoughts, or perhaps something Leslie had to say.
Yeah, I guess I'll continue on the Amendment 70 issue, which Leslie obviously supports it. I do not. You know, right now is a tricky time for Denver. Our economy has been going fairly well. You know, there's a lot of people that are moving to Denver, not only to enjoy Colorado and Denver individually, but they're coming here looking for jobs and seeking employment. And if we were to upset the economy in any major way right now, it would have a very magnified effect. And that's what Amendment 70 is going to do, is it's going to disrupt the economy and prevent people from creating the jobs that people are moving here to seek.
Okay. All right. We're going to continue, if we would, with our organizer questions. So we're going to start back with you, Leslie, and this will be a question regarding conflict of interest. Do you believe that working in or maintaining a private business for a corporation while holding public office could present a conflict of interest? You do have a minute for that response.
You know, we do have a citizen legislature here in Colorado. Our legislative session is a part-time session. And so it is really important that the folks who work at the legislature are connected to their communities. And a lot of us work and have jobs. I think it's important that we have young people running for office, like Evan and myself, who have to, you know, maintain jobs to maintain our families and our homes. And so, you know, I do believe that a lot of us do need to have jobs and will. But to your point, there may be a conflict of interest that arises, and it is our duty to make sure that we state them and that we are acting on behalf of the best interest of Coloradans and our constituents, not on behalf of ourselves.
All right, let's move to you, Evan, for that question in 1 minute as well.
Yeah, I agree a great deal with what Leslie had to say there. I mean, the legislature in the state of Colorado is a part-time, part-time is probably a relative term there, but everyone does have to have jobs on the side. You can't only have a living doing the Colorado legislature. And more so, I think it actually brings a very diverse group to the legislature, because having a background of all the different employees that people bring in, be it, you know, professionally as doctors or medical professionals, business people, that kind of round diversity brings in, you know, the kind of mindsets and different thinking that makes the legislature successful. And as far as the conflict of interest, like Leslie said, absolutely. That is on every legislature's conscience and integrity to remove themselves from situations where there is a conflict of interest.
Okay. Thank you very much. So let's move to our next question from our sponsoring partners and also the Metro State students for the candidates for State House District 8. And we're going to begin with you, Evan Vanderpool, on this one. This is kind of a broad question. Minute for the response. What makes you the best representative for District 8?
I think the thing that makes me the best candidate is my lack of government experience. That's exactly what we need, are people that have not been in government their entire lives coming back into the system and constantly having a rotating door of government employees just hopping around from different positions, and that's their only base of experience that they have. My education is in political science from Texas A&M University. So my foundation is in law, politics, and public policy. So I believe I have a very good educational foundation to build on, whereas all of my professional experience is in the business world and in the private sector. So I think I bring a perfect combination of legal principles and legal education and business world experience. And I think what people are sick of, regardless of party, is the hyper-partisanship that's taken place in our state politics and our national politics. And I bring none of that to the table.
All right, Leslie Herod, let's move to you on that response. 1 minute as well.
Yeah, I do believe that I am the best to serve House District 8. As a small business owner, I understand what small businesses go through and struggle with all the time. But also as someone who has been involved in the community, who has knocked doors, who has been to picnics and barbecues with the folks in the district, I feel like I really have my finger on the pulse as to what's important and what needs to happen for great solutions to be crafted for our community and to make District 8 even better. So I think that that's what I bring to the table. Also, it's my commitment to continuing the work. So when elected, I promise not only to represent folks in the state capitol, but to be at your barbecues, to be at the community meetings, to be at the neighborhood meetings, like I've done, to make sure that you feel like I'm accessible and that you can come to me for questions and solutions and even ideas that you have on your own. So that's what makes me the best to represent this district, and I hope the district agrees with me.
All right. Thank you. And we're going to stay with you, Leslie, on this next question. Back to crime and punishment. How would you work with law enforcement agencies to prevent crime and deal with what is perceived by some to be inequality in the state's law enforcement system? 1 minute.
Thank you. I will have to give kudos to the work of a lot of folks right now in the legislature, including Representative Andrew Williams, Javon Melton, and others who have already been working to rebuild the trust between law enforcement and the community. I'll say the work is not done. I believe that we need to work hand in hand with law enforcement to make sure that we're keeping our community safe, but also so that the community feels like they can turn to them if they need help or support. So that starts with something that, you know, my friend Chief White has said recently, that we need more data collection. We need to know who's stopping, who the police are stopping and why. We need to make sure that we are in the communities where we need to be. We have law enforcement there working hand in hand with the community, not just against the community. And those are a couple of things I think that we need to do. But this is an issue that we must address. If we don't say that we have a problem, we can't fix it. And this is a huge problem that's happening right now in our community in District 8 and really throughout the nation.
All right. Thank you. And let's come to Evan.
Could you repeat the question, Barbara?
Sure. How would you work with law enforcement agencies to prevent crime and deal with what is perceived by some as inequity in the state's law enforcement system?
Crime is a growing issue, I think, in District 8. I mean, it's been an issue. We have great police in our district, but I think crime has been growing, and I think some of that has to do with the legalization of marijuana and some of the people that has brought to Denver and the state of Colorado. I think one of the things that's important is in terms of inequalities and race relations, I think, is a big one. Obviously, it's been a hot point lately, a lot of high-profile issues in the news. And I think one of the things I really want to avoid are some bad actors in the police that have gone, obviously, far and beyond what the vast majority of our law enforcement officers do to create a culture of antagonism and resistance against the police. That's what was one of my fears whenever the Black Lives Matter movement started gaining steam, was that they were going to create a culture of resistance and put people and police officers in bad situations, and that absolutely has happened.
All right. Thank you, sir. Let's come back to our follow-up segment. Both candidates, you'll have an opportunity for 30 seconds to expand on something. I believe we started with you last time, Ms. Herod, so we'll turn to Mr. Vanderpool and let him have 30 seconds to expand on something.
Yeah, and I guess I'll continue on the on the Black Lives Matter topic. You know, obviously, Black Lives Matter has a great starting point and a great goal that they are seeking justice and equality. But we're never going to achieve equality through inequality and separating people out. That's why I think all lives matter, and that's a very important thing that we need to focus on. And not creating a culture where we're putting people into bad situations by increased confrontations with police officers.
Okay. And Leslie, would you like to add to something you had to say, or perhaps what Evan said?
Yeah, I feel like unfortunately our African American and Latino communities have already been kind of singled out and pushed aside in our community and targeted by law enforcement. We know that because we have the data to prove that, and so we know that that's happening. So that's something that's really important to me and something that we really need to work on. But the other piece is this notion that Black Lives Matters, African Americans, Latinos are putting themselves in danger and antagonizing the police, when really it's important that our law enforcement officers know how to de-escalate situations. We need more training on that, and we should hold them accountable.
Thank you. And we're going to cut you off there because we're going to move to our lightning round. And this audience members and viewers at home will be an opportunity for them to answer a question with only a yes, no, or pass. So it goes very quickly. So listen closely. A couple of the questions are for fun. And you'll enjoy these, and they just go by really quick. So get ready. We'll start with you, Leslie. Are you in favor of Amendment 72, which would increase the tax on a pack of cigarettes from 84 cents a pack to $2.59 and use the revenue to fund medical research, health clinics, and veteran services?
Yes.
Sir?
No.
Do you believe that the Colorado should enact a breed-specific law, Leslie, we're staying with you, banning pit bulls from the state? Yes or no or pass?
Pass.
No.
Okay. If a single vote could change marijuana policy in Colorado tomorrow, would you vote to keep marijuana legal?
Yes.
Yes.
All right. Have you ever played Pokemon Go? Leslie.
Yes.
No.
Okay. Do you believe there should be a citizen oversight board or a review board consisting of civilians that reviews actions of police officers at the state level, not just the city level, at the state level?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, Evan, we're going to come to you first on this question. Are you in favor of religious refusal legislation that would allow business owners, healthcare providers, and educators to refuse service to members of the LGBTQ community?
Yes.
No.
All right, we're going to stay with Evan. Do you agree with Colorado CARE, also known as Amendment 69, a system designed to finance universal health care in part by increasing income taxes in the state?
Absolutely no.
Leslie?
Pass.
All right. Have you ever used marijuana medically or recreationally?
Yes.
Pass.
Okay. Do you put green chili on your hamburgers, Evan?
Yes.
How about you, Leslie?
Sometimes.
There we go. And would you vote in favor of a lifetime ban preventing state and federal legislators from becoming lobbyists, Evan?
Pass.
Yes.
All right, let's give him a round of applause. The lightning round. It's fun, it's silly sometimes, but there's some good questions in there. All right, good job, candidates. We're going to come back to the next rounds of questioning. It's going to be your opportunity to ask a question of each other. So hopefully you'll be able to get a well-thought-out answer from your opponent. We're going to reverse the ballot order on this, and we'll begin with you, Evan. So you can ask Leslie a question, and Leslie, you'll have 1 minute to respond to that.
I guess I'll start with Pira. PIRA has a budget larger than the state of Colorado. Currently, it's been hit with billions of dollars of shortfalls in recent years due to poor planning and leadership. What are your thoughts and ideas on how to fix PIRA?
So PARA does provide a safety net, well, and retirement benefits for a lot of our public servants here in Colorado. I believe we'd be doing a disservice to get rid of PARA. But we'd also be doing a disservice if we don't work as a legislature to make sure that we keep PARA solvent. And so that is something that we have to keep our finger on the pulse of and something that I will work on. It's a long-term question, the solvency of PARA, and it's something that we have to focus on. We can't let our teachers and our firefighters and our public servants go without the benefits that we've committed to them.
All right, Leslie, a question for Evan, and he'll have a minute to
sure.
respond.
Evan, you speak a lot about the partisanship and the divisive nature of the legislature, but also of politics in general. I appreciate you speaking to that, and I think it's really important. My question for you is, what issue have you kind of broken ranks from your party on, and what will you fight for across the aisle on?
Well, I'm a firm believer that nobody has all the right answers. There's quality things to find in Democratic principles, there's quality policy solutions and Republican principles and libertarian principles. I think it's hard to find somebody that has a top to bottom list of answers to everything. And I would say my largest separations from what I'll call far right conservatism is legalization of marijuana. I think gay marriage. Legalization of marijuana and gay marriage would probably be the two largest. What I like to say is, Republicans like to be the party of freedom and the party of choice and freedom from government. But a lot of the times people stray from that path. What I like to call a la carte conservatism, where if we're going to be the freedom party of freedom, then we can't pick and choose what people are allowed to do and what people are not allowed to do. You either are for freedom or you're not.
All right. Thank you. And let's continue the one-on-one questions. We're going to come back to Mr. Vanderpool. He'll have another question for Ms. Harrod.
Yeah, you said you're a small business owner, and obviously we have a growing economy right now, but it hasn't brought everybody along, and we still have some challenges to face. What are your recommendations for how to improve the business environment in Colorado and grow the economy?
Thank you for that question. It's an important one. As a small business owner, and also working with small and large businesses in Colorado, I believe that it's important that we look to reduce certain kind of regulatory burdens that we place on businesses, make sure that any type of burden that we put on them is necessary today. It might have been put on 20 years ago and we actually don't need it anymore. So we really have to look through and get rid of ones that are just not helping us or not necessary anymore. We also have to remember to use technology to help our small businesses and our large businesses along. So when we use technology correctly, folks will save time, they'll save resources, and they'll be able to focus on growing their business, employing more Coloradans, and feeding our economy.
Okay. Thank you for that. Leslie, do you have another question for Evan?
Sure. This past legislative session, there was a lot of discussion on a piece of legislation called Ban the Box, which would take away the box that asked if you have a felony. Do you support that legislation?
I believe that was sponsored by our predecessor, Beth McCann. But no, I do not support the passage of Ban the Box legislation. And look, this is another policy that is a liberal staple, and it has a good end goal in mind, but it doesn't go about achieving it in the proper way. If businesses in Colorado could not hire any employee, any felons or anybody with a criminal history, they'd have no employees. So to tell businesses that somehow they're already discriminating and beating down on the downtrodden criminal offenders is not necessarily an accurate statement. And I think one of the things that it overlooks very much is one of the hardest things about owning a business is personnel and hiring people and finding good people to work in your company. And waiting until the last minute to where somebody has to disclose something that could potentially be a serious issue for that business isn't doing businesses any favors.
All right, thank you. And we're going to come to another question for Leslie. You'll have another opportunity, Evan, and she'll have 1 minute to respond. All right.
Yeah, Leslie, you also discussed the hyper-partisanship, and I guess I'll kind of bounce back the same question that you gave to me is, in what ways do you differ from blanket Democratic principles, or what way do you split in the most from your party?
Yeah, so I think going back to that question, I will say that, I believe it's my role not just to go with the party, but to lead the party. One of the things that I've worked on long before it was popular was same-sex marriage. I believe that's really important for our LGBT citizens and all of us to be able to be in a loving, committed relationship. Outside of that, I've actually worked on a lot of issues in a bipartisan nature with Republicans across the aisle, with independents, and that is on issues like breakfast programs for our kids in our schools. That's an issue that is not Democrat and Republican. It's not even rural and urban. It's one that really matters for our schools. And so that's something that I've already worked on and an example of what I will continue to work on. The other piece is something that we've talked about a lot tonight, which is criminal justice reform. You will see that across the aisle, folks believe and agree that we need to work on this issue to keep our community safe and to keep people out of jail.
All right. Thank you. And Leslie, if you have one more question for Evan, fire away when you're ready.
You know, going door to door through the district is something that has taught me a lot about the concerns and the priorities of folks living in our neighborhoods. One thing that came up that we haven't talked about is reproductive access to women. And so I wanted to know what your thoughts were around reproductive access and what you would do to further that in the state legislature.
Can you clarify what you mean by reproductive access?
Sure. Access to birth control, access to Planned Parenthood, for instance.
Yep, absolutely. I would say that hasn't come up yet. And that's one of the things that throughout the presidential election that has been disappointing, I guess, from my party, the Republican Party. And I think that's one of the things that's it's been lost in translation a little bit on the Donald Trump angle, is for all the things that he does say, some of the best things that he does say get lost based on some of the abstract noise. And whenever the Republican candidates were squabbling about defunding Planned Parenthood, Donald Trump was the only person that stopped and said, hey, Planned Parenthood does a tremendous amount of good for women and in the communities, and it does. It provides health care. It provides contraception. I think expanding access for women to get health care and the reproductive contraception and health that they need to get is all the better.
All right. Thank you. Candidates, we're going to move back to our follow-up segments. And this time, instead of 30 seconds, you'll actually have a minute to follow up perhaps on something you've begun a conversation on, perhaps your opponent. Each of you will begin that one-minute expansion on your ideas. And Leslie Harrod will begin with you. 1 minute.
So I have to say that I really appreciate and value Evan's perspective on reproductive health care, and wish more folks on that side of the aisle agreed. We cannot have every year folks coming up and taking or threatening to defund Planned Parenthood, whether at the state or the federal level. It's just not acceptable. And so I will work to make sure that all women, regardless of income, have access to good quality reproductive health care. It's something that is fought for too long and really just needs to be taken off the table. And I appreciate the fact that Evan agrees with that.
All right, and Evan, we'll move to you for your 1 minute follow-up.
Yeah, I guess what I'll follow up on my own question to Leslie on PIRA. And I think this is one of the biggest issues that's facing the state of Colorado. Like I said, PIRA has a budget that is larger than the entire budget of the state of Colorado. It's almost double. It's approaching $50 billion. In the past few years, it is based on unsustainable levels of gain and is billions of dollars of shortfalls each year, and the taxpayers are on the hook for anything that happens with PIRA. We have to shift from a defined benefit to a defined contribution plan. That's what everybody else in the private sector has, and that's what we make our plans for, yet we have to pay PIRA before we even allowed to save for our own retirement. Now, it is not going to be solvent. Leslie was talking about making sure it doesn't go insolvent. It is going to go insolvent. That's almost a guarantee if we stay on a defined benefit plan. We have to move that over to a defined contribution plan to continue to provide retirement benefits for the hardworking government people of the state.
All right. Thank you both for that. And we're going to come back to one more question from our forum organizers. Leslie, you'll be first on this question, related very specifically to your district. You're both vying for a position that includes Denver's historic Five Points neighborhood. As a state legislator, what can you do to preserve this district's cultural diversity in light of rising housing costs and gentrification?
Yeah. Well, I got to tell you, I love Five Points. I visit Five Points frequently. It's actually on my normal commute, and I love going down to coffee at the Point and enjoying everything that Five Points has to offer. Five Points houses some of the most, I guess, I would say amazing historic districts in Colorado, including the Russonian Hotel, where African Americans were able to play jazz, and Billie Holiday was down there. When we couldn't play anywhere else. So there's so much rich history down in Five Points, and we have to preserve it. So when we talk about affordability, we have to link arms with the business owners and the property owners in that area to make sure that we are maintaining and really keeping Five Points as a thriving neighborhood. The other piece I think about when it comes to affordability in Colorado and across Five Points is looking at getting rid of the prohibition on rent control. Now, I'm not talking about rent control of the 90s, but I'm thinking about all of the vibrant artists and the vibrant life in Five Points, okay. And think about how we can Five Points affordable for them.
All right, thank you. And we're going to come to you, Evan, for that same question. What would you do to preserve the cultural diversity in Five Points?
Yeah, I have to agree with Leslie. I mean, Five Points is an amazing part of Denver. I mean, like you said, it is a hotbed of culture, great food. You know, it speaks to a lot of issues in a lot of neighborhoods all around Colorado and Denver. Affordable housing is obviously an issue, and I think that's where there's a lot of ways to address affordable housing. Getting rid of the construction defects bill is obviously very low-hanging fruit that's been sitting around for a while that nobody's wanted to take action on until it's gotten so bad that even the Denver City Council had to take action this year, but we need to repeal it statewide. A healthy housing market has about 25% condos in an urban area like Denver, and because of the construction defects bill, I think we're around 2 or 3%. It's getting rid of a lot of low entry-level housing that's really starting to push people out of existing neighborhoods like Five Points. And to the historical district aspect, I think that's also taking place in a lot of neighborhoods where we're trying to prevent scrapes and maintain some of the charm and authenticity of our existing neighborhoods.
All right. Thank you. And we have time to squeeze in candidates. One more one-on-one question from each of you. So, Evan, we're going to start with you. If you have a question for Leslie, she'll have a minute to reply to that.
Yeah, I think one of the things that we really haven't touched much on is K-12 education, which I think is also one of the largest issues that Denver is facing. I am a large proponent of school choice programs. I'd like to know if you are a proponent of school choice or what policies you favor to fix our K-12 problem.
Yeah. Well, again, we agree that we have a problem in how Colorado is funding and administering, well, K-12 education, period. So I will say that the state's responsibility is to make sure that K-12 education is well funded, but yet we are still between 47th, 43rd in the nation for per pupil funding. Teacher pay hasn't risen in almost 20 years. We've got a huge problem on our hands. So I would say that the first thing that we must do is ensure that we have more funding for education. We do need to repeal Tabor. We need to make sure that we are doing our state's constitutional duties to fund K-12 education. That's a start, because it's just not right that depending on your zip code determines the quality of your education. That is something that we hear from time and time again in our district, and something that will be a priority for me in the state legislature.
All right, and let's move to Leslie for a question for Evan.
Sure. I'm wondering if you, I hear you talking about crime and justice a lot. I'm wondering if you support the repeal of the death penalty.
I absolutely do not. I support the death penalty very fully. And I think that's one of the, well, I'll preface this with, it's a very serious thing. However, the people that are up for the death penalty have committed serious crimes. And I think we need to maybe take better steps to make sure that the people who are up for the death penalty have very, very clear evidence from multiple sources when they're convicted, so that way it's very clear cut. However, that's one of the things I was most disappointed with Governor Hickenlooper on his staying the execution of Nathan Dunlap whenever he was coming up for his execution. Capital punishment is on the books in the state of Colorado, and that's what the people choose. So for him to insert himself like that, I thought was very disappointing, and especially for people like James Holmes. He should not be allowed to walk the streets. He should have gone to have faced the justice that he deserved.
All right. Thank you both for those questions. Very good questions. That brings us to the end of the Q&A segment, and we're going to move on, candidates, to our closing statements. Each of you will have a minute and a half, and we're going to reverse the order from the ballot order, which means Evan Vanderpool will close out for us. You have a minute and a half, sir.
Well, thank you again for having us. Thank you, Leslie. I want to challenge everybody. I want to challenge everybody to become better voters this election cycle. Regardless of your district or your political party, I want you to look deeper at the candidates and become more informed about candidates. That way you can choose who you actually want to represent you at the Capitol. your state and local government officials have the most impact on your day-to-day life. It's not the presidential election. It is your congressional election, your senators, your state and local candidates. We are the people that you're going to be seeing the most, or who you should be seeing the most, and making the most day-to-day influential decisions on your life. And even with our mail-in ballot system, Colorado voters hover between 30 and 40% voter turnout. We have to take a bigger role in our democracy and who our elected officials are. Bottom line is, we need leadership, and leadership is not voting along your party platform every step of the way. What I'd like to suggest to you is, there is no left and there is no right, there is only forward. And I would like to be the representative that takes Denver forward into the future. I ask you again for your vote and your support, and please visit votevanderpool.com if you have any questions. Thank you.
All right, and Leslie Harrod, you have a minute and a half as well.
Well, thank you for having me tonight, and thank you to the audience out there for listening. I will tell you that running for public office is one of the hardest things that I've ever done in my life, and I'm sure Evan probably feels the same. But it really matters, you know, because I believe that we all deserve a voice in the state legislature, especially the citizens and the constituents of House District 8. And that is why I've been out in the neighborhoods. That is why I've knocked your doors. That is why I'm available to you. As your next state representative, I will be accessible for your issues, for your concerns, because it does matter. We do have, as a state legislature, a lot of say in the everyday lives of Coloradans, and you should have a say in that as well. And so that is why I'm running. I will fight for good quality education, for affordability, and for criminal justice system reform. I will also fight for the other issues that matter to you, and just reach out and let me know. So please do go to my website at www.leslieharrodforcolorado.com, or you can even visit me on Facebook at facebook.com/LeslieForColorado. Thank you.
All right. Thanks to both candidates. Audience, you've been wonderfully attentive. If you would give them a round of applause. Thank you for being here as well. And thanks to both of you for being here. Our thanks also goes out to the Denver Decides partners, which include Inter-Neighborhood Cooperation, the League of Women Voters of Denver, and Denver Decides, of course, is presented by Denver 8 TV. A special thanks to the public speaking and civic engagement students from Metropolitan State University for their help with the questions as well. Remember, the election is November 8th. Let your voice be heard. Be sure you're registered, and be sure to vote. For complete election information online, go to denverdecides.org. I'm Beverly Weaver. Thanks so much for joining us.